Great. All right, I would like to go ahead and introduce our first speaker of the morning. This is Brandon. And Brandon's talk is titled, Dig Out Your Brick Phones, Bringing Amps Back with GNU Radio. Here's Brandon.
Hello, thank you, Shmoocon. My name is C-Stone, or Brandon, as she mentioned. And today I'm going to talk about some fun I've had with SDR, building an implementation, or at least a bare-bones basic prototype of a base station for amps, the advanced mobile phone system. I did this mostly as kind of a learning experience, and so I thought it would be valuable, especially following talks like Mark and Matt's yesterday morning at 10, to kind of show the practical aspects of building not just a receiver, but a transmitter for something, you know, a real live system. And so I'm gonna walk, kind of go through it piece by piece. A lot of people have asked me, why are you doing that? It's a key part of my personal history, because, 20 years ago, when these were actively being messed with, the amps, that is, it was something that was I always wanted to get into, but it was cost prohibitive at the time. But more practically, it's something that one person can do in a reasonable amount of time. I mentioned up there that the final standard for amps, for the base station to mobile station, is only 136 pages, and that's the latest one. That includes all of the blank pages and everything. The initial version was something like 60 pages, and that's all you need to do. If you can read through most of that and implement a little basic stuff, the bits and pieces that you need to accomplish certain tasks, you can have your own kind of pretend cell phone network on phones like these. This is an old Motorola flip phone. And I also wanted to see, so this network was shut down in 2008 after the FCC no longer required the holders of the licenses in that spectrum to provide this network. So it lasted for a long time. It was turned on in 83 officially, but they were running pilots in the late 70s. And it lasted until 2008, and one of those reasons is that it degraded gracefully. It was very tolerant of noise. The devices themselves, the phones, were allowed to put out, or some of them were anyway, were allowed to put out a decent amount of power. So in many rural areas, amps was actually the best way to get some kind of cell phone service. So that's one of the reasons it lasted so long. Now, every kind of, architecture, every mobile phone architecture, every radio system really is kind of a trade-off between. The power use of the devices, how efficiently you want to use the spectrum, the device cost, and security sometimes thrown in there. It wasn't really in amps, as I'll show later, but there are other factors as well. But in this case, when you consider those things, amps actually, at a protocol level, amps looks less like a modern 2G or 3G network than a It looks less like that than like a trunking network system, like the radios that the staff are using here to talk around. The concept of a call, like a phone call, like somebody being connected to another one, is not, like, I don't think that word is in the standard. It's really all about the base station telling the phones, tune here, tune there, do that, do this right now. It's a very discrete kind of thing. There's very little state. So I'm not going to talk. I obviously use GNU Radio to do that. There are many excellent introductory talks to it, so I'm not going to go over too much of the details. Just very briefly, it's essentially a DSP library where all there are bits of code that can be sources, sinks, and operators. And data flows from sources through as many operators as you want to sinks And it's how it actually works under the in the code level is there's a GUI that you can that I'll show later, and that generates a Python code that actually runs these blocks under the covers. You should watch the talk from yesterday. Mark Newlin and Matt Knight, I think. I don't remember. Sorry. Mike Osman's wonderful video tutorial series, and to get like hands-on practical experience. And you don't even need a radio for that. When I first started, I knew about what I just told you. I remembered vaguely some things about amps from 20 years ago, but you know, I had to reconcile my memory with what was actually happening. And there was no, by this time, there were no networks anymore, so it wasn't like I could easily listen in and see what things were actually going on. So I had to dig up the standards and other reference materials. The two best ones I found were a Wiley book, which I can't remember the name of, but it's in the references at the end, and there's a series of two FRAC articles from 92 by Brian Oblivion. Those actually are, they take a lot of text from the standard, but there's also a good, decent chunk of plain English descriptions to it. So where did it live in the radio? How did that work? The amps was divided into 832 different channels, and all of them in from the channels from the phones to the base station are called reverse channels, and the channels from the base station to a phone are called forward channels. Now, those were isolated. Like it's easier to make a radio device. A handheld radio device, especially, or any really, when you are transmitting and receiving with better, with good degree of isolation, separation from each other. So the way the channels work is there's a channel number. It represents two different frequencies. One for the base station, the tower, to talk to the phone, and one for the phone to talk back to the tower. So being tuned to channel 334 if the phone is tuned to 334, it means that it is listening on 880.02, and it's transmitting when it needs to on 835.02. Now, an interesting fact: like there were only 666 channels. The green things listen there, later on they decided to add more. And, well, where did that spectrum come from? These are two discrete UHF dials for US-based analog television. And the one on the left goes all the way from channels 14 to 83. And the one on the right only goes to 70, or really 69, but they, yeah. The FCC took those away, basically, in 1983. As part of the introduction of amps. But obviously TV existed before 1983. So these are discrete dials, like they click to change from one channel to another, but if you find one, if you have a device like a TV or a VCR that had a fine-tuned dial, and it predated 1983, when amps was active, you can literally use that to listen in on other people's calls from your TV or your VCR. And because the audio was modulated FM, just like the pilot signal for NTSC. Back to amps. I mentioned that the difference between forward channel, where the tower's talking down to the phone, and the reverse channel. For each one of those, there's just a control channel and a voice channel. There's only two types of channels in amps. Each one has an acronym, but they're useful for when you're reading the standard and through on. But I'm going to try to use control channel and voice channel because it's more natural. As I mentioned before, each channel identifies two different frequencies. So when a phone is generally tuned to one at a time, because it's it reduces the complexity of the device to have to monitor things. Now, where the control channels live, I list them there. There are 21 on what's called the A side and 21 what's called the B side. The way that worked is that the FCC granted two different wireless carriers a license in a given geographic area, one called A and one called B. And they had their own frequency range, and these were the control channels. Now, phones are only going to tune to those channels to listen to them, to find a tower. And they're 36 kilohertz each. So there's not much spectrum that can be used in amps. If that gets allocated and used, like by somebody, you know, if it's actively in use by someone else, you risk, if you play with amps, you risk the chance of causing disruption, which nobody wants to do. So right now it's open pretty much everywhere. So there's this interesting gap in time where you can pretty much get away with playing with amps relatively safely. That said, I'm not a lawyer. Do not listen to what I say in terms of keeping you out of trouble. Yeah, so what else do you need to know about amps? Each system network that you connect to has a system ID, and it's just a small number that when you provision a phone, when you went to the Motorola store or Radio Shack or whatever in the 80s or 90s, they would take it. They would go through this programming sequence where they would program in the system ID, some connection parameters, and the MIN, the phone, literally the phone number of the device. That phone number, the MIN, combined with the serial number of the device. Of the phone uniquely identifies it. If you have those two things, you have all you need to know to transmit and authenticate as a phone. So there are other parameters. I only listed the ones that are really important because I'll mention them later. So I want to build a base station. How do I get from here to there? The first thing I wanted to, I read a little bit more and I realized, okay, so I need to figure out how to build a control channel. And the reason is that, it's interesting to stop and think what, connected means. When your phone says, I'm connected to a network, on a modern network, it generally means that the phone has verified that it's receiving a signal from a tower. It's authenticated to it. There's definitely been several round trips, usually authentication through a secure token like a SIM card or something like that. Now, that's not true with amps. So the exception to that is emergency calls, and you don't even need a SIM card or anything to do emergency calls. But okay. On amps, it's different. You don't need to actually confirm that the tower does not need to confirm that a phone heard it at all. Like the phone, if it hears an active base station, and the base station is not saying, you're not allowed to connect here, it'll say, oh, I've got, five bars of signal or whatever. So, I'll turn on my phone, and you see right now it's flashing. It's hard to see, but maybe you can see the like flashing red thing that says no service. That's because there is no service anymore. There used to be. To make that change, to make it have, say, I've got signal, all we need to do is build a forward control channel. So, what do we need to send? Now, the forward control channel has three kinds of messages, basically. What are called overhead messages, which repeatedly send the basic parameters of the station. Things like the system ID, this is who's allowed to connect, roaming is allowed, this is when you can register, stuff like that. There are actions for, there are a few messages that you can send to all phones on the network, and it's usually things like, I'm congested, so you should only retry phone calls if they fail. You should only retry them like twice, and after that, just fail. And the third type is, talking to a specific phone. And so, when the phones are idle, they are sitting and listening to this channel and just confirming that they can hear the network, it's a network they can listen to, and they're listening for their phone number, because when a call comes in, the tower's gonna say, hey, phone, you go do this. And then the in the control channel, it's transmitting constantly. There's always data being transferred, and sometimes the tower doesn't need to send anything. So there's a kind of a filler message that goes there. So all those messages are broken up into 28-bit words plus some parity, and that becomes ends up being 40 bits. Now this is what okay good you can't read that. This is what that actually looks like. Now if you saw the talk yesterday, Mark pointed out that kind of every transmission with some notable and modern exceptions starts out with, or digital transmission anyway, starts out with an easy to sync on sequence followed by a magic number, a magic pattern that only occurs in one given place in a stream. And this is no exception here. So it sends, 10101010, then the sync word, and then it repeats the messages 5 times, and then it goes to the next one. I call that, in my code, I call it a frame. That's not a standard thing, but it just made sense. Okay, so if you look at the code, that's what this is. Also included in here, you see those arrows underneath the packets? Each one of those represents what's called a busy idle bit. This is the forward side of the control channel, which means this is where the tower is talking down to the phones. There is a corresponding reverse channel in that, and sometimes phones talk on it, sometimes they're not. But the tower needs to give some indication to phones that that channel is busy or free. When you think about it, phones need to towers are in a better position RF-wise than phones. They have giant antennas. They have more antennas. They can hear a lot of phones talking on a reverse channel, but phones can't necessarily hear each other. So there has to be a way for the tower to acknowledge, okay, now it's okay for you to transmit. Otherwise, you'll just get phones stomping all over each other. There are two different words for the basic parameters that you need to send. I'm not going to go through all of these. It's the ones you need to know are basically the SID, the system ID, which I mentioned before, it describes the number of channels in use as well. Basically, at the end of the day, we need to start out a message with those two words, and it has to be transmitted relatively periodically, according to the standard. So we know the messages we want to send. We know that we send messages in frames. Now, what does that look like? Do I just send that over and over? Is that going to work? The standard tells us that we need to resend that message roughly every 0.8 seconds. The data in the control channels is 10 kilohertz FSK. So if you do the math on that, it comes out to basically you can have a sequence of 18 or 19 different frames. And if you just start out at the top, that's hard to read, sorry. Basically the top one is the overhead word 1, overhead word 2. And then if that's all you need, you can just fill up the rest with the filler word. And then so basically I need to transmit this over and over. Okay, cool. That's the next step. Modulating, I mentioned it was FSK. It's just basic 2 FSK with an 8 kilohertz deviation. It is Manchester encoded, that's done to basically make sure that there are constant state transitions. It's called a self-clocking signal. Makes it a lot easy to makes it much easier for phones and other receivers to lock onto. So how do you do that in GNU Radio? GNU Radio's UI is clunky, but it really helps. The wealth of blocks available to do stuff like this is pretty awesome. So I start out with a source block that I've created. It's a custom block. That outputs basically, outputs ones and zeros, but the values itself it's outputting are negative one and positive one. Because FSK, there's a center frequency, and then if you're sending a zero, in general, you're never transmitting on the center frequency. Instead, you're transmitting the deviation above or beyond or below. There are exceptions because there are many variants of FSK. But in this case, you're either sending the carrier frequency, center frequency minus 8 kilohertz for zeros, or the positive for one, neglecting Manchester encoding. But this is how I'm doing it. I am generating symbols, Manchester encoded symbols, from the block at a given rate. Then I basically use the frequency mod block, and so I'm modulating ones and zeros. But as a part of that, I multiply in the deviation. So when you think about it, so I'm emitting negative one for a zero and positive one for a one. This block will modulate that and include the deviation. So it works. It's probably not the best way to do this. If you know a better way, like, let me know. And of course, if you're transmitting, you should be filtering always. And after that, I resample it and send it out to a sync. I can show you that. Then we'll get to even more fun stuff. So this is just, one of the fun, interesting things about amps is that because the channels are relatively small and they're in one place, they're not spread spectrum or anything, you can get like an old scanner and literally listen to the channels, both voice and audio. But right now we're just creating a data channel, a control channel, so let's do that. And I will turn my phone on. And starting the flow graph now. Yeah, oh crap, yeah, I know, sorry. Yeah, but now I can't see it. So. There we go. Yeah, I was off by one. That's what it sounds like. I should turn this on. Oh, it was on. So before, where there was just a red light that said no service flashing, starts off with that, but then there are, you know, it's got full signal. So now at least I have, you know, hey, back in the 90s again. Great, let's make a phone call. That's not going to work because all I've done so far is you just transmit a control channel. So let's stop that and keep going. So, okay, now what do we need to do? When I tried to make that phone call, the phone sent a message over the reverse control channel. So whatever number it was listening to that tower on, it's tuned to 45 megahertz below that, and it sent a message saying, I want to make a phone call, here's my number. That's one type of message you can put on that channel. The other ones are basically ACKing a message that got sent from the tower. The authentication stuff that was added later and registration. But that's basically it. You know, the phone doesn't need to talk to the tower very much. What this looks like is, because it needs to talk very much, it's unlike the forward control channel, it's not a continuous transmission. There are bursts of traffic that come in, and the system is designed so that no matter how hard you try, you're going to occasionally get two phones talking over each other and bursting at the same time. So there's a retry protocol and the busy idle bits, as I mentioned before. But anyway, this is essentially what it's sending. And it's very similar to the previous type of the forward control channel's transmission. You have 10, 10, 10, magic word. the word's repeated. There's also something there called DCC, and that stands for digital color code. So remember that in real life, there wasn't just one base station. There were a lot arranged in cells. Now, what happens when you're in between cells? Both towers are going to hear it. How do you avoid having to process it on both? And the way that was done is there were unique values called color codes that you had to transmit back. Basically, the tower would say, OK, you're talking to me now. Here's my color code. So every time you would send a request, the phone would send a request to the tower, it would include that. And that way, the tower and the towers next to it were set up so that their color codes were different. There was a similar thing on the analog side that I'll get to, and the voice side that I'll get to later. So how do we look for that? Start with an RF source. You isolate the signal, again, with filter. Use the demodulation and clock recovery blocks to align the samples with the spectrum. And just collect the bits in a custom block. This is how I did it. This is, if you look at other tutorials for how to receive bursty FSK traffic, it's pretty much the same thing. And you can do it without, this is what I did before. I had a custom block. I just saved it to a file and wrote Python scripts to look to see if I was doing anything right. Then I built a custom block receiving my stream of zeros and ones. So all we got to do is start looking for the preamble, the 1010, followed by the magic signal. And we're good to go. So I thought that this would be, when I did this, I didn't actually implement the busy idle bits properly because I was like, oh, that's going to be a pain in the butt. I don't want to have to actually constantly monitor and then send data from one block to another. And I figured I could just send a stream of zeros that says I'm idle, or I think it's a stream of ones, but anyway, I thought I could just say I'm idle and the phones would just transmit constantly. And then I read the standard better. It turns out that they're pretty serious about those bits, and you have a kind of tight, narrow window of time where you have to change that. Otherwise, the phone will just stop transmitting. So I would get the initial part of a block of a burst, and then it would just cut off. So I was like, fine, I'll rearrange my forward control channel block so that it's only. Its work function, the function that gets called by GNU Radio to generate samples. Before, I would just build a whole frame of the 18 or 19 messages that I showed before and just copy that out. Easy, simple. But now I had to architect this so that I'm only sending effectively 10 bits at a time so that I can send these busy idle bits. So I did all that, and it still didn't work right. I was like, I haven't tried hard enough to properly get it. And so the answer, I think the timing is wrong, and that's why I'm not doing it. And I haven't bothered doing it because while I was reading the standard, I discovered you can just turn that off. And this is, so now our message looks like that. Top two words, and then the message that says, this is what, turn off looking at the busy idle bit. In the inside my block for receiving it, there's basically, don't bother reading that. It's just a really simple sliding window type algorithm where it's looking for the sequence that I mentioned above. Better ways to do it, but this works just fine. What do you do after that? Like architecturally within GNU Radio. These are all C++ programs. You can kind of use global variables and threads and stuff like that if you want to. But it also, another way to do it is by using their message system. There's a thing called, feature called tag streams where you can send messages in line with samples. But there's also one where you can send messages asynchronously from one block to another, which is good because you don't want to do anything kind of computationally intensive in your work blocks. So what I do is I have a block that just looks for that message and then copies that and a bunch of data after it to, once it recognizes that, it sends it off to another block that actually does the decoding. So that none of that happens in line. And that takes action based on that. So now we have the phone thinks it's connected, and we can theoretically receive messages from phones. Let's see what the process is for like answering, like seeing what happens, implementing the workflow for originating a call. First, the phone sends an origination message saying, okay, here's my ESN admin, I'm making this phone call. Okay, what does that look like? All messages on the REC, the reverse control channel, have the same kind of pattern. There's words A, B, C, D, E, F. Some of them are omitted in some cases. This is the first one. The important thing is just saying, here's my phone number. This is the second one. This the local ORD queue and order. Those are the basically uniquely identifying what the phone is asking for. In the case of an origination, all three are going to be zero. And here's the serial number. This is the phone saying, here, this is who I am. Fun fact, several, I own about 20 of these phones, and maybe five of them, are sending this message with basically an invalid protocol. Like each one of these has the NAWC field, which says there are a number of additional words coming. So it says, okay, there's one more word. That way the tower knows to stop listening. These are wrong in word C from some of these phones. I don't know why yet, but I just found it funny that Motorola would like mess that up in at least some firmware versions. And then after that, you're just sending the phone number. So at the bottom there is what we need to send. And so we append our preamble to that, the 1010 and the magic word, send that stuff, and we're good. So that's what the phone's gonna send us. That's what we need to look for and parse. Okay, that's good. I'm good at parsing binary data. That is fine. That is something I can do. What happens next? Then the tower says, after it receives that message, it sends a message saying, okay, here you go to this channel, you use this power level, and you use this color code. And there's another, it's similar to the digital, it serves a similar purpose to the digital color code as well. Go that in a second. But this is what that looks like. It's pretty straightforward. It says, on the bottom one, it's the variant with VMAC and CHAN. We can send that. The process for sending that is the same exact thing as we were sending before. Then the phone tunes to that channel when it receives it, and it tunes that voice channel, and then it starts broadcasting audio, and it starts listening to the tower's voice channel. So, okay, let's talk about how voice channels work. This is the fun part. They're called voice channels, but there are also data that goes over it. They use what's called blank and burst signaling. So there's a tone called the sat tone. It's a roughly 6 kilohertz, but the exact value varies depending on the color code for the channel, or the color code assigned by the tower. And when that audio is transmitted, it means it's telling the tower or the phone that now I'm sending audio. Now it gets filtered out because 6 kilohertz is annoyingly, it would suck. And when it's not being sent in with audio, that means that it's going to send data. So it's in-band signaling. Because the values vary, it also is an important mechanism against, say, two people on the same channel on adjacent cells. You theoretically one person could hear the other if the SCCs are the same. So or if the sat tones are the same. So you don't want that. Or I mean, I want that, but most people don't want to hear other people's phone calls. The reverse voice channel, the audio from the phone, we're going to build, we don't really care about listening to that at the moment. We just want a really basic phone call to go through, since we're just trying to make a call and like hear the audio. So we use an audio, a WAV file source, and just play some audio looping continuously over the voice channel. We modulate in a 6 kHz tone, and we just use the NBFM transmit block at the same time as we're sending the control channel data. So okay, so now you know this is just one part of the graph. Now the flow graphs are starting to get more complex, and okay, but we can try this and we can see. So again, we're just going to be. There's our control channel. And
a service of Ninja Networks. Please stand by for the next available operator.
That's that annoying whistling sound, that's the sat tone. So that's what I'm sending on the forward voice channel. So now let's try to make a call and see if we can actually hear that there. So as I mentioned before, we have signal, and I know you can't see this, but it's not looking at GRC is not that much fun. Got signal. I'm going to, I guess I can, what I can do is I can put this over there. And you can see some of the debugging stuff. So I'm going to make a call, and my block is set up to listen to that message, and kind of no matter what, just tell it to tune the voice channel. Oh, got a message. Oh, it's not loud enough. Yep, sorry. I promise it's working. okay, so, all right. That wasn't, yeah. Now, let's go back and see if we can go through a little bit more. So right now, this is what the channel layout looks like. I've got the last number, or one of the next to last control channel that could be 353 is where I have my control channel. And then I'm using 356, that was the channel I just tuned to send the audio, the voice channel. Now, I mentioned earlier that you know, all you needed, so a brief interlude. I mentioned before that you didn't need to, all you needed to do was get the serial number and the MIN of a phone to be able to make calls. Like, what stops you from, you know, sniffing this and doing it, and cloning a phone, basically? And it turns out that basically nothing did, from a protocol perspective, anyway. The cellular carriers knew this would happen, But I don't know enough of the history to know why they chose not to kind of counteract this before. But one of the things they did, so but they attacked this after the fact, after cloning became a huge fraud problem. One of the things they did, and this was actually before, is they said, you know, if you're going to make handsets on amps, you are not allowed to make the ESN changeable, the serial number. It's got to be burned in, but you know we know how that game turns out. Some manufacturers are going to do a better job than others. People are going to hack the phones, whatever. Here's a picture of one of the more famous hackable phones, the Oki 900. Another countermeasure that they bolted on was they created this crappy proprietary encryption. And when the next standard that was backwards compatible with amps was introduced in the early 90s, they used it. And it encrypts both the voice data and the signaling in the ESNs. It didn't really get vetted by many people. They kept it private for a few years, and then it got leaked to Cryptome. It's where you can still download it. And very soon after, there were pretty awful attacks against it. But the interesting thing is that even though these attacks existed, none of this happened until the 90s, and there were still a ton of phones out there that were purchased before that. So even though they added this encryption and that raised the barrier for attackers, there were still plenty of targets out there. They tried to make it illegal to make or buy a scanner that covered the AMP's ranges, and this actually happened. It got attached to a bill in '92 and basically made the FCC not allow licenses for any of that stuff. As far as I know, this is still in force. Like, I think you still can't buy a scanner like this in the U.S. that can do what I was just doing. Even though, again, like this is not in use by anybody right now, and other ranges which are in use by mobile phones are, not that you can hear anything with an FM scanner, but still. Finally, after those things really weren't working very well, some of the wireless carriers even made you, like, you after you dial a phone number, they made you like type in a PIN before the call would go through. And this, obviously, this was a pain for everybody involved, but it made it a little harder to do an attack where you sniff the data, because you want to get an arbitrary, if you want to get somebody's pair, first you had to decode the reverse channel request that has a serial number, and then you have to get the forward channel's response that says you got to go to this voice channel, because the PIN transmission would happen over the voice channel. So you had to rapidly kind of get both. And if we're talking like mid-90s technology, like that might be enough to prevent people from going to higher, more complicated targets. Sorry about that. That was just a brief interlude that I wanted to show off how people cloned phones, because phone calls cost money for a while. They're kind of free now, at least in the U.S. But at the time when these phones were around and in active use, calls were billed by the minute for sure. Okay, what about when the base station makes a phone ring? How does that work? I'm not going to bore you with any more packet diagrams. I'm done with that. I'm just going to talk through the workflow for that, because a lot of the messages are the same as the things I've already covered. And if you want to implement this and look at this, you're going to need to read the standard anyway, so I'm not going to go through that. The tower sends a page message over the control channel to a given phone. Then the phone says, okay. Then the base station sends that the same message that it sent when the phone is making a call. You go to this voice channel. It sends that message now. Then the phone tunes to it and kind of waits. At that point the phone doesn't have its speaker on, but it's tuned to the channel and it's listening. On the voice channel, then the tower sends the alert message, and that makes the phone ring. And then the user answers. Actually, before that, not on this thing, is there's also a stop alert button, which tells it to stop ringing. So if you don't, different phones do that different ways. If you don't implement stop alert, which I haven't yet, you get some fun rings. Then the user answers, and the conversation goes on just like it did before. In this case, I'm going to, on 356, this is our channel layout again. On 356 is the channel I built before, where it's just looping the audio over and over again. I'm going to build another one next to that where I can actually transmit data as well. How do you accomplish that in using GRC? Because we need to transmit both data and audio and programmatically switch between the two. Obviously, you could do all the DSP yourself in a custom block and emit samples. Or you could just use mute blocks, which you can programmatically control with messages and have two parallel streams and toggle them off and on. So it's at this point, it's definitely no longer possible to show my flow graphs legibly, if it ever was. So the voice channel block looks just like the forward control channel block. It works the same way. It emits -1 and +1. Modulation is the same. And it contains, I queue up messages for to the voice channel using GNU Radio messages. Now, this stuff got hard to debug around this time because you have to constantly turn off phone or whatever. So I wanted to test just this part of it. And one thing that I didn't know you could do until I had this problem is I built a really basic CLI with the socket PDU graph. So I can telnet into this and send commands, and that goes directly to a block, and that doesn't have to go into the stream workflow or anything like that. Okay. I'm going to demo that. Now I'm going to demo making a phone ring. So, okay, cool. That's still there. And okay. Now I need the min of the phone. Let me scroll up. That was okay. Yeah. I have all the settings turned way down because, you know, I don't want to even inadvertently transmit on somebody else's stuff. So this may not work the first time, but I am going to, I'm telnetted into my thing and I'm running a page command and we'll see if it works. We'll see traffic down there. There's a couple second delay usually, but yep, okay. Now I've got a response. Womp womp. Let's try again. There we go. So yeah, that's it. And I'm running out of time, so let's see. Anything else? This work is up there now. It's on GitHub. I'll show you the link in a second. One thing I do want to show real quick is that there's a magic sequence to lock onto a message, and that means that they had to. That means that they had to avoid or design the protocol so that they had to avoid sending that signal. The only place where that could have happened is in actually sending phone numbers of devices. So it was actually restricted to have the first three digits of the phone number, not the area code, but the central office code. Many of those were actually restricted. So you couldn't have a phone number on AMPS that started with 288, for example. It was interesting that they were actually like aware of this kind of thing. As I said before, if you're going to play with this, be very careful and aware of what you're doing. Thank you, Shmoocon. That's the link to the stuff, and